Hi everyone, back in May 2022, we did a video on the channel where we looked at this. And this is a master tape of a Beatles album. It's actually a cassette master tape for Let It Be. And it came from Australia and was used by EMI Australia to produce the cassette of Let It Be and later on the album master, actually, in the 1980s. This was copied at Abbey Road on the 10th of January, 1972, and then sent out to EMI Australia. This actually is only one side of it. This is side one. I don't have side two, unfortunately. And yeah, it was originally used for the cassette, but as the note says, the tape is now in LP track order. So if you're interested in watching that video, I'll put a link to it in the description and you'll find out more about that. There it is, PCSO 7096, the Australian catalogue number. But that's not the tape we're going to be talking about today. The tape we're going to be talking about in this video is Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, which would have originally been recorded on a tape like this. This is a mid-60s, late-60s Emmy tape box with nothing on it because it's not an actual Beatles master tape. It's just a regular consumer box. You could buy these in the shops or from suppliers. But this is the box or the type of tape which would have been used to record Sgt. Pepper on. The original tape box can be seen in the Sgt. Pepper book, which I happen to have here. So this is the book that came with the box set of Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. And on this page, we've got a picture of the stereo master tape storage tin. So on this tape box, you can see the first operation from it is dated the 22nd of the 4th, 67, which is a stereo copy, which is actually before the tape box pictured on the box set was made. That was done on the 28th. So this might have been a copy for another country, and the country concerned may have returned it to Abbey Road. The tape box notes all the copies that were run off from this master tape. So looking down the list, you see you've got Holland in 1973. You've got a very interesting quad remix in April 1973 that obviously didn't come out. The copy for Apple also in 1973. Portugal, Yugoslavia, Egypt, and in between that, lots of submasters cut by HTM Harry Moss to recut the records. Sweden, South Africa 78, Japan, Chile, Sweden, Ireland, Canada. But it's this next one that we're interested in. The 22nd of the 10th, 1981, Australia, 30 IPS, 30 inches per second. So that was duplicated at double the tape speed. And looking further down the list, it seems to be the only 30 inches per second tape that was done. Because after that, you've got a sub six for the vinyl in 82, a copy in 83, a copy for Sony in 84, Italy in 86, Alan Crowder in 86 too, and then a few other ones off the side. Dolby copies, one for the CD mastering done on the 5th of May, 97. And the 15th of the 9th, 05 was the CD remastering copy. So everything, virtually everything produced on this album out there in the world has come from this tape in this box. And one of those tapes cut from that box is in this box, which we're going to look at right now. So in this box is a very special audio tape. So let's get it open and have a look. Thank you. Let's get it open. Right. It's getting very exciting. Hands are shaking a bit. Don't like using the knife when my hands are shaking, but be very careful. And then have to be careful that the adhesive tape doesn't catch the paper. Okay, right, and there's some more packing here as well. I think I'll leave the knife behind for this task. Fingers will be sufficient. Ah, that's one thing I'm happy to see, BASF tape. BASF tape is does tend to stand the test of time well, unlike, say, Ampex tape, which is prone to sticky shed syndrome, for which the only cure is baking, which means putting it in an oven at 50 degrees for 36 hours, and after which you've got a window of about 7 to 10 hours before it gets sticky again. And once it's been baked, the high frequencies tend to diminish in a way that EQing just can't bring back. And then you've got about 7 baking cycles before the oxide on the tape just falls off and it becomes junk. But this one is a BASF, which is really good. And let's have a look at it. So we've got the catalogue number, PCS07027A. YEX937, which was the code for the side one of Sergeant Pepper. So this has the note Audio 5 on the box. And if you remember a few videos ago, we unboxed and listened to and told you all about the Audio 5 pressing of Sergeant Pepper, which was a special audiophile edition, only of about a few hundred copies, which was sold exclusively at a Sydney audio show in 1983. And that record was cut from this tape. So the client is EMI Australia, and that's their reference number, Beatles matrix number. Well, the catalog number was PCS7027A, job number 5977. The tape length is 19 minutes and 44 seconds. And there is the track listing written out by hand. And the note that there are no rills, so there are no gaps between the tracks as on the original master tape. And this was cut by a mastering engineer at EMI at their Studio 301 by a very talented audio engineer called Don Bartley. There are his initials, DB, and he cut it at half speed on the 15th of April, 1982, -2 on the 8th of July, 1982, and a -3 on 15th of July, 1982. They ended up using the -3 on the pressed record. And then it was also used for the regular album PCS07027 later on in the year. But this was mastered by a different person. So the Audio 5 album has a different sound to the one cut here. I mean, I don't have this pressing, so I can't compare it with the Audio 5, but I've been told that the Audio 5 is superior. This copy was done by DRF. I'm not sure who that is. It was obviously an engineer at Abbey Road. Playback, 30 inches per second, AES non-Dolby stereo. Location 40, well, that would have been maybe room 40. And the date it was copied, 22nd of October, 1981. And tape BASF. Of course, all the Beatles albums were originally recorded on Emitape, which, despite being very abrasive on the tape heads, still holds up magnificently today after 60-odd years. But so does BASF, so that won't need baking before playing and should have held on to all its information. So that's side one. Let's have a look at side two. And we'll also have a look at one of the reels after I've undone this box. Okay, so the same. Same on the back, BASF. And there's the box here. Almost exactly the same information, except this one is YEX638, which is side two, and 7027B, side two. And it's side two is slightly shorter than side one. This is 1928 as opposed to 1944. And there's the tracks on there. Again, no reels. And this says plus voices for run out, 3 second concentric. So the run out gibberish was on this tape, 3 seconds of it. Now this one only, I needed one half speed cut by Don Bartley, whereas remember the first side needed three. So he did this once and he was happy with it. Again, the same information on there. 22nd of October, 1981. Let's have a look at the tape itself. It's the inside liner. There we go, that's on what's called a pancake reel. So instead of being a traditional metal spool, the way these things were shipped was on a pancake reel. So it's basically just one big flat wound tape on this special spool. There's a close up of the tape. It doesn't seem to have accrued any mold or any damage or anything that I can see from this angle. Well, you can probably see it better than I, but I'm certainly not handling this with my ungloved hands. And that's the end piece. Now this is what that pancake would be loaded on, onto a tape player. This is a Revox pancake reel I have, and this adapter would have slotted through the middle like this. This is a blank adapter, so the tape would go on like that, lock into those holes, and then locked into position like that. So tape's locked on the pancake here. And then that would be loaded onto the machine and rewound and then played. Unfortunately, the pancakes and the tape are too large to play on my Revox B77. So I'm gonna have to find a machine which plays back at 30 inches per second and is big enough to hold these reels. But that's a story for another video. Now, if you're wondering about the legal aspect of this tape, it's not illegal for anyone to sell any tape or to play it in your home. However, doing anything commercially with it is of course impossible. But anyway, I really hope you enjoyed looking at that tape for the first time with me, and that you'll join me again next time for some more fascinating Beatles stories. But I'll say bye for now, and thanks for watching.
Got it done then. What are we gonna do now?
Has he turned it off?
I think he has. Have you turned it off, lad? Hey, Basher.
They're still the same.
Turned it off, Basher.